Yes, sir. So good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Kanika Gupta Poddar. I'm a consultant at AMRI Hospital, Dhakuria. The topic I will be discussing today is pure red cell aplasia. So before we go over to the next, to the proper topic, we all should be well versed about what is anemia and how should we go about the diagnosis of anemia. So we should know how anemia is classified. So we start with classification of anemia. Anemias are, I'll just give a very quick brush up of this. Anemias due to impaired red cell production. It can occur due to deficiency of nutrients. The most common is the iron deficiency anemia, megaloblastic anemia, due to deficiency of folate and B12, anemia of chronic disease, sideroblastic anemia, aplastic anemia, anemia of liver disease, endocrine disorders, myelofibrosis anemia, where there is replacement of the marrow by the metastatic carcinoma cells, and also congenital dyserythropoietic anemia. Anemia can also occur due to excessive red cell destruction, that is the hemolytic anemias. This is of two types, where the abnormalities are intrinsic to the red cells, like the defects in the red cell membrane, hemoglobin defects like the thalassemias and the sickle cell anemias, defects in the enzymes like G6PD deficiencies, or it can occur due to extrinsic defects, that is the immune-mediated, autoimmune, alloimmune, drug-induced hemolytic anemias, mechanical hemolytic anemias, or by the action of various infectious agents. Hypersplenism also leads to hemolytic anemias. Anemia can also occur due to excessive blood loss. So how do we classify anemia on the basis of morphology? So when we see a slide, we see that the hemoglobin of the patient is low. Then we try to see the red blood cells and we try to see the morphology of it, whether the cells are normocytic, whether it is microcytic or it is macrocytic. This morphology of the RBCs gives us a lot of clue to the diagnosis and to how to approach and how to guide the physician as to what may be the cause of the anemia. So the macrocytic anemias are when we see that the MCVs are usually more than 100 femtoliters, and these are the macrocytic anemias. The common causes are megaloblastic anemia, liver disease, hemolytic anemia, alcoholism, MDS. Also the topic which we will discuss today, that the pure red cell aplasias may also present as macrocytic anemias. The microcytic anemias are the one where the MCVs are less than 80. The most common cause is the iron deficiency anemia. Also the hemoglobinopathy, thalassemia, anemia of chronic disease presents as microcytic anemias. And the normocytic anemias, we see that the hemoglobin is low, but the MCV is normal and the size of the RBCs are also normal. So these are the normocytic anemias. So this can occur in hemolytic anemias, aplastic anemias, also pure red cell aplasia, anemia of chronic disease, renal failures. They present as normocytic anemias. So when we see a slide and we see our machine printout, so we see the complete blood count and we see that there is low hemoglobin. So we see there is anemia. What do we do next? We see what are the associated abnormalities of WBCs and platelet. Is there any associated WBC and platelet abnormalities? Yes, there are. Then we go for a bone marrow examination. Is the abnormality restricted only to the red cells? Then we see the reticulocyte count. Reticulocyte count will also give a lot of clues to our diagnosis. If the reticulocyte count is raised, then we have to investigate for hemolytic anemias and for the blood loss. If it is not raised, then we again see the red cell indices and we classify it as microcytic, normocytic and macrocytic anemias. So now when we see the macrocytic anemias and we see that the reticulocyte count has raised, so we can say it is a hemolytic anemia or it can be due to blood loss, and we go for Coombs test and all to exclude the hemolytic anemias. But if the reticulocyte count is normal or low, that means that the bone marrow is not able to produce the RBCs. The reticulocyte count is low. Then we see the causes. So we exclude liver disease, drugs, hypothyroidism. Once we have excluded all these causes, there is no liver disease or drugs, then we have to see the bone marrow. Then the bone marrows can be normoblastic. It can be due to liver disease or hypothyroidism. It can be megaloblastic due to folate or B12 deficiency. Or it can be myelodysplasia, or the marrow can be hypocellular, then it is an aplastic anemia. Now when we are seeing a normocytic anemia, then we see the reticulocyte count again. reticulocyte count increase, it is a hemolytic anemia. When it is normal or low, again, when we are seeing a normocytic blood picture, we rule out that whether there is any chronic disease or renal failure, then we have to evaluate. If there is no such diseases, we go for the bone marrow examination to rule out aplastic anemia, myelofibrotic anemias. So this was a quick approach to all the three types of anemias, and then we see the microcytic anemias. Whenever we see a microcytic anemia, we see the serum ferritin level. When the ferritin level, that is the serum ferritin level, reflects the store of the iron. So when the serum ferritin level is low, we can say that it is an iron deficiency anemia. When the ferritin level is normal, then we go for a hemoglobin electrophoresis to exclude the thalassemias and other hemoglobinopathies. If the electrophoresis is also normal, then we have to exclude the other anemia of chronic diseases or sideroblastic anemia. Now, when we say pure red cell aplasia, so what is it? It is an uncommon disorder in which the maturation arrest occurs only in the erythrocytes. When you see the bone marrow, erythroblasts are virtually absent in the bone marrow, whereas the white blood cells and the platelets are absolutely normal. The anemia in the peripheral blood is usually normocytic or it can be macrocytic. This disease was first described in 1922 by Kuznelson, who recognized that this condition is a different entity from aplastic anemias, which presents as pancytopenia. So earlier, before this 1922, this pure red cell aplasia was clubbed under the aplastic anemia and it was clubbed under pancytopenia and nothing was clear. So now that it has formed a distinct entity from aplastic anemia, so we have to know and that what by how will we exclude aplastic anemia and pancytopenia before we reach our diagnosis of pure red cell aplasia. So when we know that we have to diagnose this, we also have to know, which is very important, why it is not this. That is more important than to say that this is this. Why this is not the diagnosis, I feel, is more important to say that this is the diagnosis. So let's see how to exclude others, and we should be well versed with the cases of pancytopenia. So when we say pancytopenia, there is a combination of anemia, leukopenia and thrombocytopenia. So by anemia, in pancytopenia it should be less than 9 g/dL, leukocyte count should be less than 4000 per cubic millimeter, and the platelet should be less than 1.4 lakh. In the leukocyte count, the neutropenia, that is the absolute neutrophil count, is much more important than the total leukopenia as such. So what causes pancytopenia? So when there is a pancytopenia, we know that these cells are not there in the peripheral blood. So where are these cells produced? These cells are produced in the bone marrow. So we need to look at the bone marrow first. So is the marrow hypocellular? So the hypocellular marrow occurs in aplastic anemia, hypoplastic MDS, post-chemotherapy, Fanconi, Diamond-Swashman. All these are hypocellular marrow and they are not producing the three lineage of cells. So it reflects as pancytopenia in the peripheral blood. If we see a cellular marrow, but there is pancytopenia, that can occur in many of the deficiency diseases or in systemic diseases. Megaloblastoma, that is the deficiency of vitamin B12, can also present as pancytopenia, folic acid deficiency. The infections like Kala Azar, many systemic diseases like SLE, Sjogren's, tuberculosis, they present as pancytopenia. Also, there are many marrow diseases where the marrow is cellular, but the cells, the trilineage hematopoiesis is not occurring properly, reflecting as pancytopenia in the peripheral blood. These are the leukemic leukemias, the hairy cell leukemias, MDS, myelofibrosis, PNH and the HLH. So when we say pancytopenias, so now we come across the bone marrow failure syndromes. The pure red cell aplasia, if we have to my screen is
hello
the ones on my screen. So we need to know the bone marrow failure syndromes. Pure red cell aplasia is a part of these bone marrow failure syndromes where there is failure of the bone marrow. What is the bone marrow failure syndromes? The bone marrow failure syndromes is a group of disorders that manifest as single cytopenia, that is the erythroid, myeloid or megakaryocytic, or as bicytopenia or pancytopenia. These cases have qualitative or quantitative abnormalities of one of the three lineages. Usually the lymphoid series is spared. It can be either inherited or it can be acquired. There is inability of the marrow cells to produce the circulating marrow cells. That is, the marrow is failing. This is a bone marrow failure syndrome. It results from reduction in the number of progenitor cells. So there is paucity of the differentiated precursors, increased number of differentiated precursors, but there is reduction of the mature cells in the peripheral blood. That is the ineffective hematopoiesis, or it can be any differentiation defects. So we see this is a bone marrow failure syndromes. It can be inherited or it can be acquired. So the inherited ones are the Fanconi anemia, congenital dyserythropoietic anemia, diamond black fin, which is a constitutional pure red cell aplasia, I will be discussing later, dyskeratosis congenita. So my purpose of showing you this along before pure red cell aplasia is, I just told you that pure red cell aplasia presents as anemia. Then I told it is a bone marrow failure syndromes. So there are other bone marrow failure syndromes also which presents as anemia. So again, like I said, so we should always know why it is not the other diagnosis and why we are pointing out to our diagnosis. So as you can see here, the congenital dyserythropoietic anemia also presents as anemia. Diamond black fin syndrome presents as anemia. Also the Schwarzman diamond syndrome presents as anemia. And what are the acquired bone marrow failure syndromes? Aplastic anemia, pure red cell aplasia, PNH, MDH, AML, myelofibrosis, they all present as bone marrow failure syndromes. These are the acquired ones. So now we know, we are well versed with the other terms. Now we will read about the pure red cell aplasia. It is the anemia which with marked reduction or absence of erythroid precursors in the bone marrow, along with normal myelopoiesis and megakaryopoiesis. So there is defect only in the erythroid lineage. The myelopoiesis and the megakaryopoiesis is absolutely normal. The anemia is usually normocytic, normochromic. Sometimes it can be macrocytic, and there is reticulocytopenia. The reticulocyte count is low. The diagnosis is based on the bone marrow examination where the erythroblasts are virtually absent, less than 1% of the marrow differential count, and there will be increase in the lymphoid aggregates in the bone marrow. So what are the causes of pure red cell aplasia? It is congenital or acquired. The congenital form is the diamond black fin syndrome. Earlier Pearson syndrome was also included. Now they do not include this here anymore. Now the acquired can be primary acquired or it can be secondary acquired. The secondary acquired is secondary to infections, the most common being the parvovirus B19, which causes the pure red cell aplasia. Also, it can be secondary to any drugs. It can be secondary to autoimmune disorders. Thymoma is a very common malignancy which presents as pure red cell aplasia also. It can occur secondary to lymphoid disorders. It can occur secondary to NHL, CLL. It can also occur secondary in pregnancy. It can occur in immunocompromised states, Hodgkin lymphoma. A wide array of these diseases leads to secondary pure red cell aplasia. So we have to be very conscious and we should know this topic very well, because we usually get this sort of pure red cell aplasia in our daily clinical practice. So other causes, like you can see CLL cases, T-cell lymphoma, CML cases, all these, any cancer patients can present as pure red cell aplasia later during the course of their therapy. So one, we start with the congenital cause, that is the diamond black fin anemia. It is a congenital, chronic, or regenerative anemia. It is a congenital form. In this disorder, there is injury to stem cells in utero and is associated with certain physical abnormalities. 90% of these cases are sporadic, while 10% are also hereditary. Most of these cases are autosomal dominant, while it can also be autosomal recessive. There is defect in the ribosome synthesis. The physical abnormalities which can give a clue to the diagnosis is short stature, mental retardation, microcephaly, cleft palate, macroglossia, micrognathia, cardiac septal defects, urogenital defects and deformities of the thumb. Genetic mapping when done indicate that that the disease is localized on the chromosome 19q13.2. So there is pallor, weakness, dyspnea, all attributable to anemia during the first 2 years of life, and many cases are diagnosed within the first 3 months of life. In these patients, so there is anemia, low reticulocyte count, again the white blood cells and the platelets are absolutely normal. There is increase in the hemoglobin F concentration, erythrocyte adenosine deaminase as well as erythropoietin level. There is high density of I antigen on the red cells. Serum iron, ferritin, folic acid, B12 levels are raised. Once we see the bone marrow, it will see that there is selective deficiency of the erythroblasts in the bone marrow. Few pro-erythroblasts may be seen. The ME ratio varies from 10.1 to 50 to 1. The myeloposis and megakaryopoiesis are essentially normal in a normocellular marrow. There is increase in lymphocytes in the marrow. So this is the bone marrow picture of a patient of pure red cell aplasia. So as you see, we can see all the erythroid precursors. There is absence of erythroid precursors. We can see that there are all the myeloid precursors, the megakaryocytes are there, but there is virtually no erythroid precursors in the bone marrow. The marrow is cellular. The marrow is cellular and there is absence of erythroid precursors in the marrow. So now we come over the acquired causes. The acquired primary. Primary is when we do not get any secondary causes. Acquired primary pure red cell aplasia occurs at an age of 60 years. Rare familial cases have been reported. Male-female ratio is 2:1. Primary pure red cell aplasia, it has an autoimmune diseases, usually clonal T cell proliferative disorder in which there are T cells which suppress the erythropoiesis. So since the T cells has been modulated to cause the pure red cell aplasia, the treatment usually includes immunosuppression and immunomodulation. Various drugs like the immunosuppressive drugs, corticosteroids have been tried. Other modalities of treatment like splenectomy, plasmapheresis, stem cell transplantation. Recently, anti-CD20 monoclonal antibodies, rituximab, have been tried. Cyclosporin A gives wonderful results in these cases of primary acquired pure red cell aplasia. It acts by inhibiting interleukin-2 production by the T lymphocytes, which in turn prevents the cytotoxic T cell activation. Amongst all these modalities, cyclosporin A is the most successful drug. Another entity is the transient erythroblastopenia of childhood. This is a sort of secondary pure red cell aplasia. It is frequently seen in children of 3 months to 4 years of age. The mothers usually give a history of preceding viral infection and it is a very transient thing. So usually it can be missed also. This type of pure red cell aplasia is common in healthy children. It is very self-limiting, so it goes unreported. Patients present with severe anemia, pallor, weakness, dyspnea, tachycardia, and they will give a history of preceding respiratory illness, enteritis, any HIV infection, infectious mononucleosis, mumps, and all these are, they give a history. Anemia is barely noticeable, reticulocyte count is low, bone marrow shows very few erythroblasts, and the marrow is cellular, myelopoiesis and megakaryopoiesis is normal. So the bone marrow picture is very clear. The marrow, first of all, it is a cellular marrow. Then once we start with the cellularity of the marrow, then we go over to see the megakaryocytes. You will see megakaryocytes, so it will be normal megakaryopoiesis. Then again, when we see the other cell lineages, we will see normal myeloposis, there will be sequential maturation up to the neutrophils, we will see mature neutrophils, we will see lymphocytes, plasma cells, but what we cannot see is the erythroid lineage of the cells. There is destruction of the normoblasts, which is brought about by the antibodies directed against the red cell precursors or the erythropoietin. Lysis of the erythroblast is brought about by the NK cells through the T cell receptor mediated antigen recognition, and the affected progenitor cells possess ECO receptors. In the acute pure red cell dysplasia, the disease states like infectious mononucleosis, atypical pneumonia, parvovirus, mumps, it all should be ruled out. Parvovirus V19 infection, pure red cell aplasia. It is very common and very common in India. So parvovirus B19 directly infects the erythroid progenitors through the P antigen on erythroid surface. Individuals who lack these P antigens are resistant to parvovirus infection. Human parvovirus B19 is responsible for pure red cell aplasia of sudden development in cases of hereditary spherocytosis, sickle cell anemia. So these patients already suffer from a disease like hereditary, and they are complicated with parvovirus 19 infection, and they get a pure red cell aplasia. Of all the causes, this of all the causes of pure red cell aplasia, this parvovirus B19 infection is most commonly implicated in causing this. This virus also affects individuals who are immunocompromised or on immunosuppressive therapies, and they result in a chronic suppressive state. So when we say again the bone marrow, again it is a normal cellular marrow, normal myeloproliferation, normal megakaryoproliferation with severely diminished erythroid precursors. The clue to the diagnosis of parvovirus B19 infection in the bone marrow is the giant proerythroblast. I will show you the pictures with basophilic cytoplasm. See, these are the giant proerythroblasts. They have basophilic cytoplasm with dog ear-like extensions. So these are the dog ear-like cytoplasmic projections. They have stippled chromatins and they have inclusions. These inclusions looks like nucleoli in the bone marrow aspiration smears, but they are actually not nucleoli. They are the inclusions. So we have these giant proerythroblasts with basophilic cytoplasm, dog ear-like cytoplasmic projections, stippled chromatin, inclusions like nucleoli, and this points to the diagnosis that yes, we are dealing with a case of pure red cell aplasia due to parvovirus B19 infection. The inclusions resemble nucleoli in the aspiration smears, but when we look at the refined biopsy sections, then we will make out that no, these are inclusions. The giant proerythroblast demonstrates positivity with Ki-67 once we stain them with the immunohistochemistical stains. So these are the giant proerythroblasts. Again, see, these are the giant proerythroblasts and how. How can we differentiate this from megakaryoblasts? These giant proerythroblasts have perfectly round nuclear outline. See, again, we can see the stippled chromatin here, and there is an inclusion here which looks like nucleoli. Again, there are more pictures. So this is a trephine biopsy section. As you can see, it is cellular. There is nothing hypocellular about the marrow, but we can see these giant proerythroblasts. See, these are the inclusions. These are not nucleoli. These are the giant proerythroblasts. Again, another trephine biopsy picture. It is a perfectly cellular marrow. We can see a very nice myeloproliferation happening. But there is a giant proerythroblast and virtually absence of any erythroid cells in the marrow. So another infection which I'm just telling you is the cytomegalovirus infection. In cytomegalovirus infection, there can be a secondary pure red cell aplasia, and we get these multinucleated erythroblast cells. So this occurs in a cytomegalovirus infection. Now we go over to the secondary causes of pure red cell aplasia. Most cases are seen in people over 50 years of age. A number of cases of pure red cell aplasia is associated with thymoma. Erythropoiesis is restored after thymectomy in 26% of cases. However, only 4% of cases of patients with thymoma develop erythroid aplasia. These patients demonstrate pallor and the physical findings of underlying thymoma. Other disorders like lymphoproliferative disorder and autoimmune disorders may also be implicated. Pure red cell aplasia is associated with all other disorders like autoimmune disorders like SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, chronic active hepatitis, and chronic lymphoproliferative disorders. It can also be associated with myasthenia gravis and other autoimmune disorders. Antibodies in autoimmune disorders affect the erythroid precursors, and in some cases, the role of NK T cells have been elucidated. Pleural cell aplasias also occur with other lymphoproliferative disorders like CLL, LGL, Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's, and Waldenstrom macroglobulinemia. Congenital dissent. So this was all about the pure red cell aplasias. Now before I started off with the pure red cell aplasia, I had shown you a chart about the bone marrow failure syndromes where we saw that there was anemias in congenital dyserythropoietic anemia. So congenital dyserythropoietic anemia also there is anemia. So in the peripheral blood, when we are seeing anemia, so how do we know in the bone marrow that we are dealing with pure red cell aplasia or we are dealing with congenital dyserythropoietic anemias? So we should also know that how congenital dyserythropoietic anemias look like in the bone marrows. So what is CDAs? It is a rare autosomal recessive disorders characterized by anemia, jaundice, reduced red cell survival. This disease also affects the erythroid lineage of cells. There is failure of terminal erythropoiesis. There is complete sparing of myeloid and megakaryocytic cell lines. So it is a very important differential in pure red cell aplasias. It is of three types, type 1, 2, 3. Type 1 and 2 is autosomal recessive and the type 3 is autosomal dominant. So I will show you the bone marrow pictures of all the three types. So this is my first type, the CDA type 1. In CDA type, so first, the most important thing that we observe that no, the erythroid cells are not absent in congenital dyserythropoietic anemia. In fact, they are present. There may be erythroid hyperplasia, but the erythroid cells will show dyserythropoiesis because as I pointed out, there is failure of terminal erythropoiesis. There is ineffective erythropoiesis. So we will get erythroid precursors, we will get the erythroid cells, but there will be dyserythropoiesis. So as we can see, this is the features of dyserythropoiesis. We can see cytoplasmic bridging over here. There is one more dumbbell-shaped cell that is a characteristic of CDA type 1, and we can see the cytoplasmic bridging over here. We coming over to the CDA type 2. The characteristic cell in CDA type 2 is the binucleate erythroblast. So this is the binucleate erythroblast. So first pointers towards the distinction from pure red cell aplasia to CDA is very simple, because in pure red cell aplasia, we will hardly get the erythroid precursors, let alone the dyserythropoiesis. So in CDA, when we see anemia, when we see that only the red cell lineage is affected, we see the bone marrow. When we see the bone marrows, we see that the bone marrow is cellular, but we see that there is absence of the erythroid precursors.
No worry, take your time.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But we, so I was like, sir, I'll take one moment. Hello. So can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So I'm already logged in. Again, I'm facing the same problem. And I can hear twice.
Yeah, I think your voice is echoing. You just exit, come back again. I mean, you shut your system and start again. No, jo pura band kar diye, pura system band kar diye. Restart.
Sir, can you see the screen?
Yeah.
So I was discussing the CDAs and how to differentiate it from the pure red cell aplasias. So when we see that we see anemia in the peripheral blood, we go for the bone marrows. The marrow is cellular in both pure red cell aplasia and CDAs. But in pure red cell aplasia, virtually there is no erythroid lineage cells, whereas in CDA, we see the erythroid cells and there is just erythropoiesis. So in CDA type 1, we see these cells, the dumbbell-shaped cells with chromatin bridges. The CDA type 2, the characteristic cells are the binucleate erythroid cells. And in the CDA type 3, we see this giant multinucleated erythroid cells. So it is very important to know the other types also. Also, one of the most common disorders that we hear the name about is the Schwann diamond syndrome, because we already discussed the diamond blackfin syndromes. So it is also an autosomal recessive disorder. There is bone marrow failure. Along with it, there is an exocrine pancreatic insufficiency and increased risk of myelodysplasia and leukemia. It is caused by biallelic mutations in the SBDS gene on chromosome 9. So now that the pure red cell aplasias have been given a distinct entity from aplastic anemia, it will be nice if we just quickly have a short recap of what an aplastic anemia is, and that also how the bone marrow of an aplastic anemia looks like, so that we confidently know that no, it is not aplastic, yes, it is pure red cell aplasia, and we know the bone marrow pictures of all the diseases. So this is the aplastic anemia. How do we say it is aplastic? Because there is pancytopenia. So aplastic anemia is diagnosed if any two of the following is present in the peripheral blood: hemoglobin less than 10, neutrophil count less than 1500 per cubic millimeter, and platelets less than 50,000. Also, the absolute reticulocyte count is low. In addition, the bone marrows in aplastic anemia is hypocellular. That is less than 25% of the normal cellularity for that age. Also, there should be no abnormal infiltrate or increase in reticulin of the marrow. So the causes can be idiopathic, drugs, chemicals, ionizing radiation, infectious diseases, Fanconi anemia, Schwann diamond, as I just discussed, diamond blackfin anemia. See, it is also discussed under aplastic anemia, and it is a constitutional pure red cell aplasia. So there is an overlap of all these diseases. The peripheral blood, we see that there is usually normocytic anemias. It can also be macrocytic, and there is preponderance of these lymphoid cells. The lymphocytes are there in the peripheral blood. And now, as you see the bone marrow picture, it is a hypocellular marrow. The fat spaces are more prominent, and there is clusters of these lymphoid cells and the plasma cells that we see in the bone marrow. This is a trephine biopsy. In the trephine biopsy, we see these hypocellular areas, and the intervening, we see these cellular areas. These cellular areas in an aplastic cases, these are the hot spots. So in these areas, there is some sort of erythropoiesis, myelopoiesis is going on, which reflects as the peripheral blood cells. So now we see some of the case reports so that we understand our topics better. That is, so an 11-year-old boy presented with pallor which required multiple packed red cell transfusions. He did not have any hepatosplenomegaly, jaundice or lymphadenopathy. So we excluded all the other disorders: hepatosplenomegaly, jaundice, lymphadenopathy. Bone marrow examination was done and it revealed pure red cell aplasia. So all the possible secondary causes had to be excluded before coming out to the diagnosis of pure red cell aplasia. Then it was found that the RA factor and the ANA was positive. So as I already discussed, that the primary acquired pure red cell aplasia, it has an autoimmune basis, and the other secondary causes will be absent. So the RA factor was found to be positive. Then the child was started on oral steroids, to which he did not respond, and then cyclosporin A was given and it showed dramatic response. Another case of a 42-year-old lady who presented with progressive pallor for 1 year. So the chest x-ray shows a large paracardiac mass on the right side. So it is that, again, the CT scan shows a well-delineated mass on the anterior mediastinum. So it was a case of thymoma. So this was the thymoma slide that we came across. Surgical excision and histopathological examination revealed it to be a thymoma, and then following surgery, the marrow showed erythroid regeneration. Another case of a 42-year-old male who had a history of ankylosing spondylosis for 14 years. Then after that, he got serious anemia. Bone marrow show indicated pure red cell aplasia. So we see all the other lineages, but virtually absence of the erythroid lineages. So it is a case of secondary pure red cell aplasia. Many other case reports I came across while searching for this topic, that is, there was cases of pure red cell aplasia in patients of rheumatoid arthritis. There were cases of pure red cell aplasia secondary to pregnancy, I already mentioned in the causes. There were cases of pure red cell aplasia in patients with adult onset still disease, in cases with T cell lymphoma. So secondary pure red cell aplasia is still a very common disease. It occurs secondary to many of these disorders. And so the take-home message for my presentation is that the pure red cell aplasia, the what we have to remember, it is anemia, anemia, anemia. It affects the erythroid lineage of cells. There is marked reduction or absence of the erythroid precursors in the bone marrow, and there is normal myelopoiesis and megakaryopoiesis. And also, when we get this, we also always have to look for any secondary causes, the infections, drugs, thymoma, and the lymphoproliferative disorders. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kanika. Wonderful presentation. Slight hiccups, I think that was technical. That was not in your control.
Sorry, I'll be very serious.
No, not at all to be sorry. These are all technical issues. We cannot control these things, and this is part of the whole process. And, you know, so...
I think when we get the hack of it, and so it will be better with every presentation.
But we are more concentrating on the content. The content was very good. You really worked very hard on the content. It can be very clearly seen. Not only did you talk about PRCA, but you talked about PRCA with CDA, with aplastic anemia, how the anemia should be approached, and then how you reach to a point where you can really pick up PRCA. Because this is exactly how a person should think, and we are so happy to see that you have a very thoughtful concept about how anemia should be addressed. And if you don't teach it like that, then the people will not understand how to pick up PRCA, because it's not an easy pickup. So if you know how to approach anemia, if you know how to approach anemia, then you know how to go about it, then you know how to look at the reticulocyte counts, then you know exactly when you go to the bone marrow what you see, and if what you are seeing is a different from CDA or AA. Very nicely presented.
Exactly. This was the whole motive, actually, when we look at these cases. So how do we go about in our clinical practice? We try to present it that way so that the students, when they read it and when they come to the clinical practice, they know how to approach it and what to exclude the others before coming to the diagnosis of
pure red cell aplasia. Absolutely fine. Yeah, absolutely right. The technical issues are always a part of the process, and I don't think so. That is not given
any importance. Apologize for that.
No, please don't apologize. It's you have no control on that. So it was a very nice presentation. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Please share the PDF of this. I will.
We will come back to you for another topic.
Yes, my pleasure. Yeah. Thank you, sir, for giving this opportunity.
Always welcome. The pleasure is all mine.
Thank you so much.
Take care. Bye-bye. Thank you. God bless you. Bye.